put your worship right there in this moment. In these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Come on, say, take all. Woo! I have in these hands and multiply, God. All that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire.
Ask him.
Set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life. Gracefully broken, my heart stands.
Reverence to the Almighty God, and thanks be to Him for the blessings of another day. We greet you in the holy and high name of Jesus. We thank Him for the blessings that He is bestowing upon us. We thank Him for the opportunity to study His Word and to share His Word with you as we look at our Sunday school lesson for May 31st, fifth Sunday of May. This is lesson 14 in the series, and the subject matter in our study is pursue love and justice. The scripture references for this particular study come out of both the 11th and the 12th chapter of the book of Hosea. And let us look at the appointed scriptures as we make ready to study this lesson. It begins with Hosea chapter 11, verses 1 and 2, and then we move to verses 7 through 10. It's King James Version. When Israel was a child, then I loved him and called my son out of Egypt. And as they called them, so they went from them. They sacrificed unto Balaam and burned incense to graven images. Skip down to verse 7. And my people are bent to backsliding from me. Though they call them to the Most High, none at all would exalt him. How shall I give thee up, Ephraim? How shall I deliver thee, Israel? How shall I make thee as Admah? How shall I see thee as Zeboim? Mine heart is turned within me, and my repenting are kindled together. I will not execute the fierceness of mine anger. I will not return to destroy Ephraim, for I am God and not man, the Holy One in the midst of thee, and I will not enter into the city. They shall walk after the Lord. He shall roar like a lion. When he shall roar, then the children shall tremble from the west. Second part of our lesson comes from Hosea chapter 12. There we look at verses 1 and 2. And then verses 6 through 14. Ephraim feedeth on wind and follow after the east wind. He daily increases lies and desolation, and they do make a covenant with the Assyrians, and oil is carried into Egypt. The Lord had also a controversy with Judah and will punish Jacob according to his ways, according to his doing, will he recompense him. Then verses, skipping down to verse 6, therefore turn thou to thy God, keep mercy and judgment, and wait on thy God continually. He is a merchant. The balances of deceit are in his hand. He loveth to oppress. And Ephraim saith, yet I am become rich. I have found me out substance. In all my labors, they shall find none iniquity in me that were sin. And I that am the Lord thy God from the land of Egypt will yet make thee to dwell in tabernacles, as in the days of the solemn feasts. I have also spoken by the prophets, and I have multiplied visions and used similitudes by the ministry of the prophets. Is there iniquity in Gilead? Surely they are vanity. They sacrifice bullocks in Gilgal. Yea, their altars are as heaps in the furrows of the fields. Verse 12, and Jacob fled into the country of Syria, and Israel served for a wife, and for a wife he kept sheep. And by a prophet the Lord brought Israel out of Egypt, and by a prophet was he preserved. Ephraim provoked him to anger most bitterly. Therefore shall he leave his blood upon him, and his reproach shall his Lord return unto him. A key verse from these two chapters, chapter 11 and chapter 12 of Hosea, is out of Hosea chapter 12. Verse 6, turn thou to thy God, keep mercy and judgment, and wait on thy God continually. And this is a word, of course, to us today, that we need to turn to our God. We need to keep mercy and judgment and wait on our God continually. As we face this pandemic in 2020, we are put in a position of waiting on our God. And we need to identify that this lesson is given to us out of the love of God for us, but at the same time, he's calling us to be faithful to him. This lesson is divided into two parts of discussion, and of course, the natural divide are the chapters, chapter 11, verses 1 and 2, and then 7 through 10 is talking about the Father's faithfulness. The first thing is God's action. Second thing, Israel's reaction. The third thing is God's decision. And the fourth thing is Israel's future. Then part 2 of this lesson, again, out of the natural divide, Hosea chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, and then verses 6 through 14, and the subject matter there is God, or the Lord's resolution. Charges of sin. Number 1, directions for return. Number 2, persistence in wickedness. Number 3, plan for reconciliation. Number 4, and number 5, resistance to the plan. Our author today is a man by the name of Hosea. Hosea ministered to the northern kingdom of Israel in the mid-8th century B.C. And this nation at that time looked beautiful on the surface. The nation appeared to have it all together, but it was rotten to the core on the inside because it had forsaken the God that initially made them a nation and brought them out of Egypt. And God had had enough of Israel's revolting behavior. A general timeline of Hosea's prophetic ministry is about 755 to 725 BC. This is computed with reference to the reigns listed in Hosea chapter 1, verse 1, as well as the fact that the northern kingdom of Israel, Hosea's primary focus, ceased to exist in 722 BC. Israel's king, Jeroboam II, listed in Hosea 1 and 1, reigned from about 793 to 753 BC. He was a strong ruler politically. He expanded Israel's borders, made Israel the leading nation in Palestine and Syria. So according to 2 Kings chapter 14, verses 23 through 29, Israel was wealthy and proud of its success, turning their back on God. The people also found it all too easy to shift allegiance to the fictitious deity known as Baal. Hosea 2, verse 8, and then verse 13. This went hand in hand with injustice, which is talked about in Hosea chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. In confronting this idolatry, God called Hosea to live out a unique and difficult parable of God's love for Israel. As you know, that was one of the similitudes that God had Hosea to go and marry a harlot, a woman of the streets. And I believe personally that he fell in love with her, because you can marry somebody and if you don't love them, what they do don't bother you. But if you love them, then what they do bother you. So Hosea's style did not involve pronouncing what we might call highly directed prophecies, those beginning with the command, hear the word of the Lord, followed by named addresses, the way other prophets did. You'll see that in Jeremiah chapter 10 and Jeremiah chapter 22. Two exceptions are found in Hosea 4 and 1 and Hosea 5 and 1. Following those pronouncements, Hosea simply continued his general pronouncements. Hosea simply continued his general prophetic pronouncements on wayward Israel. For this reason, the organization of the book can be difficult sometimes to determine, but here's what we got. The first thing we want to look at in our discussion is the Father's faithfulness. Hosea chapter 11. Verses 1 and 2, and then verses 7 through 10. Verse 1 talks about God's action. When Israel was a child, then I loved him, listen, and called my son out of Egypt. Hosea tells the story of God's interactions with Israel, beginning with the Exodus out of Egypt. That event and the giving of the law at Sinai launched Israel really as a nation. Calling Israel a child reinforces that this was a formative experience. God is determined that leadership and people of Israel understand the coming prophecy first and foremost in terms of his love. God wants us to know that he loves us. In spite of the degradation of our nation, in spite of the ungodly behavior that is going on around us, God still loves his people. Matthew uses this very text to describe the return of young Jesus from Egypt in Matthew 2:15. That story too should be read in light of God's love. Jesus is the ultimate expression of that love. Verse 2 and 7 talks about Israel's reaction. As they called them, so they went from them. They sacrificed unto Baalim, and burned incense to graven images. The designation Baalim is the plural word for Baal, refers to the fictitious gods of other nations, particularly the Canaanites. This is a term that generally has the sense of Lord or Master. But no matter how persistently God has called Israel to him, the people insist on doing the opposite and embracing idolatry. Though the people may still be offering sacrifice to the Lord and celebrating his feasts, celebrating their Sabbath day behavior, they also burn incense to idols. The hearts of the people are untrue to the very God who gave birth to their nation. By bringing them from Egypt and giving them a land of their own, these people are reflective of what's going on in our nation today. We done forgot the God who has helped to make us a nation. And our worship and our dedication to him are but symbolic tokens rather than real total commitment. Verse 7 says, and my people are bent to backsliding from me. God's frustration with the Israelites is quite apparent. Their choice is not accidental due to ignorance, quite the opposite. Theirs is a committed intent to turn away from him. The northern kingdom of Israel mirrors the southern kingdom of Judah in this regard. They knew better. They just chose to go their own way, believing that God loved them too much to punish them or to turn against them. They are playing both sides. It's similar to the way Gomer did Hosea. And that's another discussion. Verse 7b says, though they call them to the Most High, none at all would exalt him. So the meaning of the Hebrew text is not entirely clear, but I'm going to tell you what my clarity is. They knew who they should be serving, but they decided to serve somebody else. It's like a man that is given his devotion, his life, his love, his money, his commitment to his wife or his woman, and she takes his money and go and spend it on another man. And don't feel guilty about it. She feels that he loves her so much that she can have it both ways. So likely the people are worshiping Canaanite deities even as they continue to say the right things about the Most High God. Because of their utter refusal to abandon idolatry, God will not exalt them by delivering them. Look at God's decision. That's verse 8 and 9. How shall I give thee up, Ephraim? How shall I deliver thee, Israel? How shall I make thee as Admah? How shall I set thee as Zeboim? Mine heart is turned within me. My repenting is kindled together. I love you so much, but I got to let things go. And I got to give you your recompense for your behavior. We're looking at parallel structure of Hebrew poetry again. Is evident as the second question creatively rephrases the first. Ephraim is another way of referring to the northern kingdom of Israel, Ephraim being the name of Joseph's youngest son who received the blessing from Jacob And he became, of course, one of the most powerful of the tribes. So Israel is identified with Ephraim, one of his leading tribes. Likewise, the fourth question rephrases the third, Atma and Ebohim. These are sister cities of the infamous Sodom and Gomorrah. It was more than just Sodom and Gomorrah. These were the little cities around them. And what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah happened to Adma and Ebohim. The thought of punishing Israel as he did those cities breaks God's heart. Amen. You know how your daddy and mama used to say, this hurts me more than it hurts you, but I got to do it. It breaks God's heart, but he had to do it. He is one who takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from his way and live. That's what he said in Ezekiel 33:11. Language of turn and repenting does not mean that God is feeling remorse as though he has done or is planning to do wrong. It just means that he don't want to see it come to this, but it has come to this. He has to deal with them after their sins and after their decisions. Rather, the sense is that compassion tempers his anger. He's compassionate about them, but his anger is tempered because he can't believe that they are allowing this to go on. Verse 9 says, I will not execute the fierceness of mine anger. I will not return to destroy Ephraim, for I am God and not man, the Holy One in the midst of thee, and I will not enter into the city. So this is not first time that God's compassion tempers his anger. Look at 2 Samuel chapter 24, verses 15 through 25. Unlike people prone to overreact in their anger, God is always thoughtful and measured in his actions. But eventually, God will act. For God to refer to himself as the Holy One in the midst of thee reminds his covenant people that although he is present with them, he also is entirely different from them. His ways are not human ways. This verse in its context is valuable for glimpsing God's two overarching characteristics of holiness, which is talked about in Isaiah 63 and over Revelation 4 and 8, and love, talked about in 1 John 4:8 and verse 16. Neither one is subordinate to the other. God's holiness called forth retributive expressions of his wrath, while God's love calls forth restorative expressions of his wrath. So we got a God that's dealing with both. Wrath is imminent, but God is going to deal with it both from his two perspectives. But we thank God for his love. God's love, God loves his children, but he has to continue with them. Centuries after the time of Hosea, the self-sacrifice of Jesus on the cross will satisfy the requirements of both God's holiness and God's love. As sin is punished to satisfy the requirements of God's holiness, the path to eternal life is thereby open in satisfying the requirement of God's love. Life in the presence of our holy God become possible as sin's price is paid. Fourthly, Israel's future, verse 10. They shall walk after the Lord. He shall roar like a lion. When he shall roar, the children shall tremble from the west. Look, they shall walk after the Lord will be the result of God's restorative discipline. The figurative roar, like a lion by God, will be the sign of Israel, to return. God is going to speak. And just like he can send punishment, he can send deliverance. Return from exile by the southern kingdom of Judah will be from the east. But the return with trembling from the west is clarified as tremble as a bird out of Egypt. This brings us full circle to the out of Egypt, talked about in Hosea 11:1. Israel shall realize that God can just as well act as a lion in a destructive sense. And when God roars, we need to pay attention. When God roars. The second part of our lesson in our discussion deals with the Lord's resolution. In Hosea chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, and then verses 6 through 14. The first part, or the A part of this, is the charges of sin, which is Hosea chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. The second part of our discussion is the Lord's resolution. Hosea chapter 12, verses 1, 2, and then verses 6 through 14. The first part, part one of that, is charges of sin, which are found in verses 1 and 2. Ephraim feedeth on wind and follow after the east wind. He daily increases lies and desolation, and they do make a covenant with the Assyrians, and oil is carried into Egypt. For Ephraim, of course, another reference to Israel or the northern kingdom, the name of Joseph's youngest son who had received the blessing from Joseph's father, Jacob. And even when Joseph tried to tell his father, he said, your hands are crossed. You got your hands on the wrong one. He said, no, I know what I'm doing. Amen. And that is, of course, a stretch. But he crossed his hands in order to show who he wanted to be ruler, or to have the authoritative promise that was passed down by Abraham to Isaac, and Isaac ultimately to Jacob. And that's another discussion. But Ephraim is that son who received the blessings. And Ephraim he feeded on the wind and follow after the east wind can be another way of referring to a covenant with the Assyrians, an economic treaty with Egypt that involves oil. Rather than seeking God as an ally, the king of Israel has turned to world powers for security. And we thought, and many people believe now in America, that our security is in our military strength, that our security is in our financial strength. But the truth is, my brothers and sisters, our security is in our God. Treaties are important. World order is important. But the greatest relationship we can have as a nation and as individuals is our relationship with God. But rather than seeking God as an ally, the king of Israel has turned to world powers for security. Verse 2 says, the Lord hath also a controversy with Judah and will punish Jacob according to his ways. According to his doing will he recompense him. Recompense, payback. This is the formal language of a lawsuit. Like any legal arrangement, there are consequences for breaking the contract. These consequences are agreed on before signing. As the name Ephraim in our text refers to the entire northern kingdom of Israel, so also Jacob here refers to Judah. Judah would do well to see how God judges the north and repent while there is time. Don't you see what God is doing? Don't you see what God is able and capable of doing? Don't you see the necessity of being in the right relationship with God? Not just having allies in the political arena, or allies in the public leadership arena, or allies even in the hierarchy of ecclesiastical arenas. The greatest thing you need to do is have God as your allies. Look at the directions for a return. God gives a direction. Whenever we falter, God gives a direction. If we would only listen and read his word, God gives us a direction for return. Verse 6 says, therefore turn thou to thy God. Keep mercy and judgment and wait on thy God continually. The language of turn thou to thy God is language of repentance from sin. But this turn of the heart must be evidenced by a turn of behavior. Some people think turn of the heart is go and join that church and shake hands with the preacher and decide you're going to give $20 a week to that church and you're going to go as many Sundays as you can out of the month, but you really not made a commitment to God. Your Monday through Friday have not really changed, but it's just your Saturday and Sunday, or maybe just your Sunday has changed for a few hours. That's not the type of repentance and commitment that is being called for. This turn of the heart must be evidenced by a turn in behavior. Any turn of heart must be accompanied by exercising the mercy and judgment, which is justice, that mirrors God's own character. Further, to wait on the Lord continually is not a suggestion of mere passive patience. Rather, this imperative conveys the idea of an active and complete trust in God's plan and timing. God knows what he's doing. And Granny say he may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. This will demonstrate repentance from relying on earthly powers instead of relying on the Lord. And there are a lot of people who rely, they say they rely on the God. They rely on God, but it seemed like they relying on their earthly resources. Third thing he says, persistence in wickedness. He is a merchant. The balances of deceit are in his hand. He loveth to oppress. So the nation is portrayed as a greedy shopkeeper who gleefully use balances of deceit as false weights or false scales to oppress or to cheat customers. Verse 8 says, and Ephraim said, yet I am become rich. I have found me out substance in all my labors. They shall find none iniquity in me that were sin. Ill-gotten gains breeds arrogance. People will steal and say, I deserve this. They steal stuff from the job. It's as hard as they work me and they don't pay me right. I deserve to take this stuff. I deserve, and in reality, it's really ill-gotten gain. And it's nothing to brag about, and it should not bring you to a position of arrogance. Unchecked arrogance eventually results in self-deluding sense of invisibility. They shall find none iniquity in me. And a lot of people think there's no iniquity in them till they read the word of God. Revelation 3:17 warns against the same self-delusion in the first century AD. This danger seems ever greater in our society today. Men and women brag about ill-gotten gain, which breeds arrogance, stealing people's cars, breaking in people's cars and houses and taking things, going and bragging to your friends about this. Ill-gotten gain breeds arrogance. But this same arrogance is going to lead you to destruction. Number four, plan for reconciliation. Verse 9 says, "And I that am the Lord thy God from the land of Egypt will yet make thee to dwell in tabernacles as in the days of the solemn feasts." Mention of the Exodus from the land of Egypt again brings the prophecy back to Hosea 11:1. To dwell in tabernacles referred to the annual feast of tabernacles. During this week-long observant, Israelites live in temporary huts or booths, tabernacles, to remember their days of God's protection in the wilderness. And we need to be reminded of what God has done for us and where God has brought us from. I had a crazy idea some 35 years ago when I was a young pastor of hanging cotton sacks and chopping holes on the wall of the church and say, remember when, and remember where God has brought us from. Look at what God has done for us. And every now and then we need reminding, and yes, the Jews still practice those temporary dwelling places during their celebrations of the feast, the Feast of Tabernacles. But it does seem just superficial practicing and not realistic observation and connection to God. For they get up out of those superficial tabernacles and they still continue to cheat and to take advantage of and to misuse other people. Something's wrong. It was an effort to bring the people back to him. God would send them through a wilderness experience again in the form of exile, plagues, and viruses can be wilderness experiences for some of us. And one thing we note about viruses and wilderness, always there were people that died, the guilty and the innocent. And what it does is shock us sometime back into the reality of how fragile we are and how much we need God. I need him every day and every hour. Songwriter said, I need him in the morning. I need him at the noonday. I need him when the sun is going down. I need him in the midnight hour. And I realize when I see what God is doing and I see the power of God, just how much I need him to get us through this wilderness type experience. I have also, verse 10, spoken by the prophets, and I have multiplied visions and used similitudes by the ministry of the prophets. And one of those similitudes that I've already alluded to is Hosea's actual relationship with Gomer, the birth of his children, her going away, selling herself until she becomes almost valueless. And then the Lord says to Hosea, go get Gomer. Go pay for her. Go bring her back. If you really love her, no matter what she's done, bring her back and restore her. That's how I feel about Israel. By this time, God has spoken by the prophets plainly. He's also communicated through visions. He's also showed similitudes, riddles, parables, whatever it takes to try to get his people to get the point. Do you see what I'm trying to say to you? You can't understand the words, it appears, or you resist the words, so I can show you sometime better than I can tell you. I can show you that you do need my protection. I can show you that you do need my love. Resistance, though, huh? That was resistance even to this plan. That's verses 11 through 14. Is there iniquity in Gilead? Surely they are vanity. They sacrifice bullocks in Gilgal. Yea, their altars are as heaps in the furrows of the field. This is a good example of a prophetic riddle God posed to Israel. Earlier in Hosea's prophecies, he had introduced Gilgal as the site of a major pagan shrine. Gilgal is west of the Jordan rivers and close to Jericho. The location of the city of Gilead is unknown, but it parallels Gilgal in iniquity. God speaks of the people's pride in both the shrine and their agricultural wealth. But Gilead's altars to other gods make it as unfruitful as its fields were sown with rocks instead of fertile soil. Verse 12 says, and Jacob fled into the country of Syria, and Israel served for a wife, and for a wife he kept sheep. God continues the riddle of nothing, but noting Jacob's experience with Laban, his uncle. Although Jacob initially fled to Laban for safety, Jacob did not find the haven he hoped for. Jacob, later called Israel, was deceived in his marriage and ultimately sensed the need to flee. Similarly, Israel is looking to Egypt and Assyria for safety, but will eventually find Egypt to be powerless and Assyria to be a deadly enemy. The one you expected to deliver you might be the one that throws you down or overcomes you or overpowers you. Amen. A lot of people looking to the lottery. I want my lottery dream home. And instead of getting out of the lottery, a lottery dream home, you get lottery poverty where you lose everything. It's because you're looking in the wrong place. You need to look to God. Verse 13, and by a prophet, the Lord brought Israel out of Egypt. And by a prophet was he preserved. The power of the clergy, and I use that word clergy as similitude to the priesthood and the prophecy of the Old Testament, but the power is ignored. The importance is ignored until times of crisis. But they have been very significant in the work of God. They have been the ones who have been on the front line of declaring the power and the presence and the work and the work of God. And I want to just say this, that I'm not hearing enough prophetic voices speaking and saying God is trying to tell us something. God is talking to us in this pandemic. Is this pandemic God's way of making us look up to him, lifting our eyes to the hills from whence cometh our help? I was blessed to hear Charles Stanley this morning speak on that, and I agree and applaud him for having the audacity, because he's a well-known evangelist preacher in our society today, and for him to say God is seeking our attention. And I say to you, and I've said it more than once, but I'm just an insignificant little preacher in St. Louis who just dares to try to stand on the word of God. But I say to you, God is talking to us because of our apathy, our loss of love. We have moved from relationship with God to apostasy, which means we've turned away from God and we're seeking other means of communicating with the divine. We're seeking other ways of reaching heaven other than by Jesus Christ. And it has led our nation into anarchy. And a lot of time we think of anarchy is just a rebellion of the people against established law. But no, lawmakers and keepers of the law, police officers, government agencies, government leaders, military leaders, generals are showing their ungodliness and even showing some of them their racism. And that's anarchy. That's going to lead to a destructive force within our nation. Amen. And we pray for peace. We pray for the presence of God and the Holy Ghost. But I think I need to just put people on notice that there is a boiling point that is being reached in our nation in several communities. There is a boiling point, and those who think themselves superior, those that think themselves unconquerable, they are going to find out that the very people that you brought in to destroy might end up being the people you have to serve. I know that scares people to death, because the truth is, when you study history, and those real historians know that what we see now has not always existed. The color of skin being the determining factor in leadership. Look at the hieroglyphics of Egypt and see who was in charge and see who was doing the work and who was cracking the whip. And I believe that's a great fear deep on the inside that many people have, because they see that God has shed his blessings upon different people and different races. And you can't turn the blessings of God. You can try to kill off the people, but you can't turn the blessings of God. God is going to act. And Lord, give me the power, give me the strength, and give me the determination to not be afraid to speak when that prophetic voice come up. And so, and by a prophet, the Lord brought the Israel out of Egypt. We know he's talking about Moses. God now speaks plainly again. Listening to Hosea is the same as listening to the prophetic Moses of long ago. Both speak God's words. Just as God led Israel out of slavery under Moses, God can lead the Israelites away from a second captivity and exile if they listen to this prophetic voice of Hosea. Verse 14 says, even Ephraim provoked him to anger most bitterly. Therefore shall he leave his blood upon him, and his reproach shall his Lord return unto him. God repeats his warnings. Ephraim, Israel, you're going to face the consequences of your actions. America, Europe, you're going to face the consequences of your actions. And because you're on top now, you need to remember you haven't always been on top. So others have been. And because you are now, don't forget the God who has brought you. God's protection, if we're not careful, will be withdrawn. Arrogant Israel's injustice and idolatry will result in national destruction. What about arrogant America? Arrogant America and its injustice and its idolatry, where will it lead us as a nation? What's the conclusion of this matter? All too frequently, we feel the sneaky satisfaction of having gotten away with something. And our choices often convey to others that we are the most important people in our lives. We feel secure because of what we own or what we know. When trouble comes, we try to solve our own problems by way of people and stuff. Suddenly, Israel looks as unfamiliar as our reflection in the mirror. It found out that it did not have the power to resolve all of the troubles that would come, nor would their affiliation with other so-called powerful nations ultimately deliver them. Egypt failed. Assyria rose. Assyria failed. Babylon rose up. Babylon failed. Cyrus rose up. And Alexander the Great and the Greeks showed up and the Romans showed up. But every nation that has not maintained its allegiance with God has ultimately failed. And God is still in control. It's time to leave those things behind and trust in God. It's time to show through our actions that we follow God and God only. I pray, dear God, help us put hands and feet to our claims to follow you. And convict us when we don't. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Let love and justice characterize your life. Love people. Do right by them. And God will do right by you. God bless you. Have a wonderful Sunday school celebration. If you're not having class, just enjoy the word yourself. Call somebody up. Have a watch party and discuss the lesson. Zoom somebody. FaceTime somebody. So let's just look at this word together. God bless you. And we continue to pray for God's blessings to be with us. Amen.
All to Jesus now. Yeah. All to